there's a lot of concern about free speech codes on campuses, you mentioned trigger warnings, Ann Coulter, Neil Ferguson got into trouble recently. Some of these are public universities. What do you think the responsibility is for free speech advocates to address some of these domestic issues?
I absolutely believe that the campus situation is particularly important in this country for all of the reasons that the Supreme Court has said, that academic freedom, freedom of thought, freedom of inquiry, freedom of debate and dissent is especially important in these institutions that are designed for education and in particular for preparing the next generation of citizens and leaders in this country. And if people develop a hostility, or first of all, if they're ignorant at best, second, hostile at worst toward free speech values, our free speech rights are going to be in jeopardy. I really agree with Zechariah Chafee, who was the first major free speech scholar in this country, a professor at Harvard Law School in the early 20th century, one of the founders of the ACLU. And he said, in the long run, people in this country will have just as much freedom of speech as they want. In other words, if we demand of those we elect that they respect free speech, they will. And if we allow them to censor, they will. And then they'll appoint judges who also don't support free speech. So I couldn't agree with you more that this is of vital concern. And I spend most of my time on the campus lecture circuit for that reason. And I'm happy to report that there has been a lot of pushback, including several new organizations on campus, some of which have organically sprung up from students themselves. So there's a wonderful group called Bridge USA, which is getting an award from Heterodox Academy, another wonderful new institution that was formed a couple of years ago to stimulate heterodox thinking and debate and discussion on campus. Again, I'm pointing at Pamela because she's been very active, and I'm on the board of that as well. FIRE, the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education, again, another common cause, has been excellent. The ACLU brought the initial lawsuit against the first campus hate speech code that was adopted by the University of Michigan in the late 1980s, and we brought several others, and FIRE has taken over as specializing in the issue. Every single hate speech code that has been challenged in court has been struck down as either overbroad or unduly vague. There's just no way to avoid those problems. And if I can tell you one little anecdote about this, it's when the ACLU challenged the University of Michigan's hate speech code, which was very typical. I mean, there aren't that many synonyms you can come up with. A term hate is itself an emotion, inherently ambiguous, subjective, disparaging, demeaning, victimizing, stigmatizing. And the judge, Averyn Cohn, asked the university's lawyer, well, you acknowledge that offensive speech is constitutionally protected. Yes, that's absolutely, nobody would disagree with that major tenet of constitutional law. So how do you distinguish, the judge asked the lawyer, offensive speech from speech that is, and therefore protected, from speech that is disparaging or degrading or demeaning and therefore not constitutionally protected? And the lawyer's answer, how do I distinguish that? Very carefully. So he had a great sense of humor, but it's no laughing matter. And I do have to underscore that one of the authors of that code was Lee Bollinger, who is now the longtime, he was then the dean of the University of Michigan Law School, now the president of the Columbia University. And all of these college codes had the input of the top free speech experts on their faculty. So it's just impossible to come up with language that does anything other than give unfettered subjective discretion to the enforcing authorities. And that's why we see the enforcement patterns that we do, which are not friendly to minority groups.